All right. Chatima tova, chatima tova to all. Shana tova, shana tova. All right. So, the lecture of today is OMG, I sinned. What should I do? It was funny, because we sent the when we sent the notes. So somebody said, "Oh my goodness, not this guy! He sent OMG." I said, "What did he do already?" So it was very funny. But no, Baruch Hashem, he didn't do any avera. However, the question is asked. You know, is always asked. You know, you wake up like this all of a sudden, or you realize, "Oh my goodness! Oh my goodness! Great balls of fire! You know, I did an avera. I sinned. What do I do? What do I do?" So my question to you is, okay, what the person should do? Or what, not what should he do? Let's put it this way. What usually happens when a person realizes that he did an avera, he sinned, he did an avera? I don't really like the word sin. I did an avera. I think it's a little out of context if we use the word sin and we don't address the word avera. And we'll see. Well, usually what happens to a person who does an avera? What happens? Anybody knows? Avi? David? Rachamim? What happens? No. What happens? Okay, he says, okay, you know what? I did something wrong. I did an avera. Oh my goodness, what did I do? What happens? Anybody?
Regret.
Okay, what else happened? Yeah. Huh? That book, what is it like? God is an accountant, it's right to move. What do you do? Leave me alone from Shamayim. What do you do when a person doesn't have a person, not in Shamayim? Huh?
You admit what you do.
You admit what you do. And then what?
What do you do right away?
I'll tell you what you do. You guys don't know anything. You do it again. You do an avera. You say, oh my goodness. I feel bad. I do it again. Nothing happened. Do it again. It's exactly what happens. It's exactly what happens. And it becomes a pattern. It goes like this. Okay, I did something wrong. Should not have really done this. I'm really sorry I done this. I shouldn't really have done this. All right. You know, I'll try next time. What happens? Boom, again. Up again, done again. Up again, done again. Up again, done again. You get sick from this kind of emotion. Up and down, up and down. You get sick from it. But nevertheless, it doesn't stop anybody. And then what happens? Something very simple. One day, that individual wakes up and says, you know what? I really tried to do my best not to do avirot. I really tried. You know, I'm an honest person. I don't think it's for me. I don't think this religious life is for me. I mean, I really tried. And they go. And the question is, why do we do that? What happens that we develop this pattern, this repeated behavior of on again and off again and on again and off again and on? It's very simple, guys. It's very simple. We never actually sat down and thought about it. We think HaKadosh Baruch Hu is some kind of guy who sits up there, writes in the books, okay, erases this, then does the total, you know, or runs in a machine, or puts it in the program, Microsoft Excel, I don't know, whatever, you know. You think that that's what it is? All right, goodbye. It's over. Not understanding what it is. I told the guys earlier this week about a martial art master. His name is Master Oyama, the founder of Kyokushin Karate, which was a extremely strong individual. I'll take another one, that's fine. Extremely strong individual with many people were petrified when he was young and so on. You know, got into a bad vibe, as they say, while he was this, end up in jail, beat up some American soldiers right after the occupation of Japan. Something happened to him when he was a child also. Anyway, end up in jail, and then he simply thought about himself. So where am I going with this? And my father words that told me, listen, what is going to be with you actually going to become a reality for me. I'm going to be no good. And he snapped out of it, and he developed this system where he expects the people not only to do hee-ha in terms of the karate, but expect them to live up in a certain moral and virtues in life. So why he could have done it and we don't? The answer is very simple. He was sitting 6 months, 8 months, whatever months he was sitting in a prison cell all alone, and he actually thought about himself. What's going to be with it? We don't do that. We don't give ourselves the time of the day to think about what we do. And if we do, because of the way society is, that God forbid you'll do anything wrong. You know, in our society today, there's no such thing as doing the wrong thing. Everything is okay. Of course, maybe besides being a Jew, that is okay. You know, if you're a Jew, everybody can say anything about you, can do anything for you. You know, this is like the hypocrisy of our society, unfortunately. There's some people who run to office in Kentucky and they said, let's get rid of the Jews. It's all about them, right? You know, you should know about those things. Don't live in La La Land. Wake up and smell the hummus, as they say. But that's what happens. It's everything is okay besides being a Jew. You know, you could do this, you could do that, you can do the other thing, and it's all okay. And the worst thing about it is the silence of the lamb. You know, it's the silence of your friends that would not say, hey, what are you doing? The mitzvah tochecha, the rebuking that we give a friend to another because I care about you. I'm saying, what are you doing? People say, what do you mean, what am I doing? What are you telling me what to do? I'm trying to help you. That's how you tell me? But showing me, yes, I'm trying to help you. Put those markers. Mister, wake up a little bit. You know, like you're driving in a road. So you drive on the road, on the highway, they have those like grids like this. They go on the side. So if you fall asleep and all of a sudden you hear it, you wake up. And then they try even further. They put those, you know, the railings on the side. I mean, why should they care? You want to go fall asleep, goodbye, go, forget off the road, who cares? But these are your friends. We don't do that. We don't have any indications. Now they're trying to put even a system in cars that when you fall asleep, it kind of wakes you up or stops or whatever it does. What do you learn from this? You refer to it only for sleeping. But guess what? Ben Adam, Malecha Nirdam. We are all sleeping in our lives. Our lives is one big shlufi. We are asleep. And we never think about what we do. And we don't, why don't we? Because maybe sometimes we don't even know what happens to us when we do an avera. And I'm deliberately using the word avera. In Catholicism, there is a concept, if a person does a sin, he goes to the confession chamber over there and says, oh, Father, forgive me for I sin. What did you do? I did this, I did that. Okay, do 20 Hail Marys, do this, do that. And, you know, try not to do this again. Goodbye, good luck. We don't work like that. We don't say, oh, Father, forgive me for I sin. We say, Habibi, reg. Vidui, v'charata, v'azivat ached, vidui. I did it, charata. You have to regret it. And you have to leave, drop. The chet, what does it mean, drop the chet? Chet is not a chefetz, it's not an object. The avera is an entity, is a creation that we had made to ourselves. And we need to simply drop that pattern. And we need to analyze what happened to us. And we don't do it. And today we don't have friends to tell us, hey, what happened to you, you know? You just got married 3 months ago. What happened? We haven't seen you in yeshiva for 20 years now. I mean, 3 weeks, 3 months, whatever time it is. What happened to you? Not that I care what happened. Maybe something happens. Maybe he needs help. Maybe something happens. He can't come. Do we really care about the other guy? We don't care. So that's what we don't say. And if we say, it's not because we care. And that's a problem. That pattern has to stop. If you haven't seen somebody in yeshiva, they used to come to yeshiva on a regular basis. How many of you actually picked up the phone and say, hey man, where are you? What's going on with you? Are you okay? Is everything okay? Maybe he's sick. Maybe he's sick. Maybe he needs help. Maybe, I don't know, maybe he's fallen and he can't get up. You haven't seen somebody for 3 days. God forbid, maybe he fell in the apartment or in his house and he can't reach anyone. Did you ever make an effort? But you don't care. And you don't care. And caring is something very important. Caring is like hating on the two extremes. You can't say, I only hate this kind of people and I love everybody else. Or I only care about this kind of people and I love everybody else. Or I don't care about everybody. No, no. Caring and hate, it's something that applies to all parts of your life. As I said to you many times, you would not find in the whole entire Torah one commandment that we are commanded to hate someone. Even Amalek, it doesn't say to hate Amalek, it says to erase Amalek, not to hate. Why? Because hate would penetrate into you and you won't be able to get rid of it. It's like a bug, it's a leech, it's a parasite. So today I hate my enemy, today, tomorrow I hate my brother. Hate is bad. Caring, if you are a caring person, you care for any human being. It doesn't make a difference if it's a Jew or a Gentile. You need to care. Of course, you shouldn't be stupid. You know, if a guy puts a gun to your head or threatens to behead you, you know, listen, you know, let's take care of you first, then I'll take care of you. However, you know, a person is a person. It doesn't make a difference if he's a Christian or Muslim and you're a Jew and he's a Buddhist. It doesn't make a difference. Caring is caring. Do you care? Do we really care? And what does it mean to do an avera, to do a sin? What does it mean to do an avera? Sin sounds like something out of like, you know, Dante's, you know, like hell, something, you know, it's like, you know, sin. I'm a sinner. I'm not a sinner. What do you mean I'm a sinner? Sin is not a truly Jewish concept. Chet, avera. Lehachati something, lechatot, is if I have, for example, a scratch, and want to put some alcohol to do what?
Sterilize
it. That's chitui. It's not the same shorish, but it sounds the same. A chet happens when I have some kind of an infection in me, an intruder into my system. The different types of intruders, right, doctor? The different types of intruders. Sometimes could be a dust in your nostril, and that will be cause an allergy reaction. You know, you will need to take some antihistamines, and hopefully it will go away. You might have a bacteria in your body. You might have a virus in your body. And you might have, God forbid, a cancer within that will eat you up. When a person does a chet, means that something penetrated into him and disturbed the harmony of the system of the person. Now, our body, our physiological body, works in harmony until that harmony is being disturbed, right? Like Newton's law, right? We have a certain state of equilibrium, unless that was disturbed one way or another. Whether it's stress or an accident, or wrong diet. Not generally, to most part, we were born healthy. But we disturb this balance and we become sick. Spiritually, it works the same way. We were born healthy. We were born pure. We were born pure. The Rambam writes again and again and a million agains, fifth chapter of Halachot Shuvah to the Rambam, is a fundamental chapter in understand Judaism. We don't really look at it so much. It's something that I can tell you for myself. I keep on reading. I don't know how many times I went back to this small chapter in Halachot Shuvah to the Rambam. And with great amazement, I always find new things and depths that I just didn't see before. We were all born pure. And it was the choices that we made to become impure. Albert, there's some stuff there if you want to nush and eat. And so when this equilibrium is being disrupted spiritually, then I become spiritually sick. So it could be something little. You know, like a little allergen that causes me to sneeze. But if I keep on going, let's say I'm allergic to dust, so I'll keep on coming into a dusty place, the allergy is going to get more severe. I'm going to have a runny nose. I'm going to get some, post nasal drip, sinus infection, headaches. I can actually become sick from that. Even develop asthma, an asthmatic reaction, which is terrible. Spiritually happens the same way. It could be something little, minor, tiny little thing. It could be a scratch in your foot that you didn't pay attention, and all of a sudden you got some cellulitis out of it and end up with extreme pain. Yeah, I mean, just from a scratch. Or get a little scratch, God forbid, and get like those people, you know, that had like these flesh-eating bacteria in their body. There's a flesh or a soul-eating bacteria as well that causes us an imbalance, that tips it out, that then causes us to do that avera. Avera and chet are a little different. Avera comes from la'avor al dvar Hashem. La'avor means, who cares? Avor, leave it alone. HaKadosh Baruch Hu told us, God told us, listen, do one thing. For example, told us, be shomer negiya. Hizaru be'arayot. Eat kosher. Nothing happens. That's an avera. Avarti al dvar Hashem. But then I need to realize, why is it bad? What happens to me when I do those things? Let me explain to you something. Most people are not happy. Most people are not happy. They might feel bursts of happiness from time to time, but ultimately, believe it or not, most people are not happy. According to the Kabbalah, the reason why people are not happy is because happiness is a sense of fulfillment, to be full, to feel something meaningful. That's the cause of happiness. Your child does something terrific. Anything like this, all of a sudden you feel happy. Something good happened, you feel happy. We have emptiness, we are a vessel. And that vessel is empty. When we don't fill it with substance, we feel empty. Sometimes we do avirot, we're not careful, and we get little holes, bigger holes, into the vessel. And then not only we feel empty, we feel the drafts of the wind coming in. And so therefore we try to feel that emptiness inside of us. I'm feeling empty, many people say. I feel empty. So what do we fill this up? Instead of filling up to patch the hole, to do proper, cement and sheetrock and this and that and plaster and whatever needs to be done, we fill it up with air. Those bursts of air, like those, instead of smelling, planting a garden, a rose garden or jasmine garden that will smell good, right? We take air freshener. It ends. There's no substance to it. So we fill our emptiness with little things that mean absolutely nothing. They don't last. We buy ourselves a new jewelry. We buy a new car. We do all these things that, and we feel this great excitement. He bought me a ring. Wow, it's beautiful. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. 5 minutes later, you look at it. A day later, it's, how do you like your ring, honey? It's nice, it's nice. I like it. You don't know what I'm talking about. You'll see what I'm talking about. Guarantee. Unless you're going to fill your life with substance. You come and you tell your wife, honey, I just finished Masechet Shabbat. We're doing a seal. That's substance, happiness, and accomplishment. The reason why we feel empty is because we don't want to work hard. Success, when you go to the gym, right? Or you work hard. Some of those very dedicated people, believe me, Don't change the shirt. You have one shirt they wear. You know why? Yeah, it smells bad, but it smells like success. If you're wearing clothing, or let's say you wear a karate gi, if your karate gi is always white and clean and nothing on it, and your belt is ironed, you know it was not used a lot. The beauty of a belt is what, sensei? When it's already ripping, right? Like fringes coming out of it. Lehavdil elef alfei avdalot. The beauty of a etrog is when it has spots of, you know, because when you touch the etrog, there's little spots of, from your sweat, creates a chemical reaction. The Chatam Sofer says, that's the beauty of an etrog. Why is it beautiful? Because somebody used it. The etrog is like, doing mitzvah, put it in the box. You have a beautiful box. You have this huge silver box that costs a lot of money. You take your etrog that you bargain for. The etrog, you make the bracha, that you bargain. $30 for an etrog. My son told me, he saw today etrogim in Israel, there were like 300 shekels. I said, Gilad, 300 shekels, a lot of money. It's a whole set. He said, no, Abba, it's just the etrog. The lulav is separated. It's a mitzvah. In America, all is a, $30 for an etrog, man, it's expensive. And they cheat us, little lemons they give us, you know. Meanwhile, I buy a box for $2,000, Achim Chadad, something, you know, made in Italy by a, you know, blind man. Ooh, I take the lulav, die, the etrog, I put it inside. I don't want to say, oh, the box is important, the inside, yeah, chamor. This is, the mitzvah is on the etrog, not on the box. What are you looking at? There's no substance. And now, no wonder you tell me, I don't feel anything. You know, I shook the lulav, I took the about meaning, I don't feel anything. Because you don't care about it. I want to see you guys. I mean, you guys are still students. But Be'ezrat Hashem, we're going to become rich and have Parnassa. By the way, does that, until that time, does not stop anybody to help the yeshiva, right? Because you know that we need help. By the way, I just want to tell you, apropos, if anybody wants to make a donation, you can either send us a check to a mailing address or go to the PayPal account or just bring it over to the guys, one of the guys here, and then we'll deposit. Because we want to do two things. We want to build and we want to expand. But we don't want to be just buildings. Eventually, the goal will be to have our own building where we can have a dormitory and have guys feeling at home there and guys that cannot afford. Again, we don't charge to learn, but we need help. But we do want to try to buy a Sefer Torah for the yeshiva so they can use it on Shabbat, they can use it in Chagim, and so on and so forth. So if you find a little corner in your heart and in your pocket, it will be greatly appreciated. You can contact our administrator, Yonatan, through the email at rabbigaon@gmail.com. If you have any questions, we'll answer it there. Just apropos that. So when you become very rich and give us, of course, your ma'aser. I was saying anyway. Anyway, so you'll become rich, right? I do expect you, for example, and you see it's going to be totally different. When you're going to buy yourself an etrog that costs $100, only the etrog, or $200, or $250. And you take this etrog, you're going to say, wow, it's a etrog, I want to hold it. You develop appreciation to it because you work hard for it. However, you don't appreciate what somebody does to you when he sells you an etrog, which is a nice kosher etrog for $35. You know, you feel, and you don't appreciate it. There's no substance. What happens to us because of that is, I don't want to do this. Oh, I'm going to cut corners here. And I don't feel it. And I don't feel it. And then your son would not feel it. And then it's gone. But you have to know to understand one thing. Every time we do an avera, every time we do a sin, we do an avera, we do a chet, something does happen. Our neshama gets a little dot, a little tear. I can have the biggest rope. I've seen rope, you know, I went to the Intrepid like, you know, a few years ago with my kids. I saw the rope in which they tied the boat. There's rope, I've never seen such a rope in my life. It's just this big rope. It's amazing. our neshama is like a trunk, a roof that is connected up. And we're doing avera. Listen, there are a lot of fibers in that rope, but I can go every single time. I have this huge, giant rope. Every day, I cut another fiber. Every day, well, you think one day it's not going to rip? Of course it's going to rip. Every time we do an avera, it's another disconnect. And those veins in the rope that are the neshama is connected, these are the veins of lifehood, of spiritual lifehood that gives us the nourishment to live. So when I do an avera, I'm cutting nourishment. I'm cutting my life. Another one less. Another one less. Another one less. Here we'll be cutting. In a real body, we'll be like, if every time, what will happen here, Dani? What will happen if I take a fishing line, and then I'll tie it tight on my pinky, on the edge of my pinky? What will happen? How long? A day? A day. One day without blood supply, the blood brings the soul, the lifehood into the organ. One day without it, pow, it's gone. And then I take it out, and then what happens? Chas v'shalom, it could spread gangrene all over your body and you die, and it smells. Rabotai, mitzvot have a fragrance also. Mitzvot have a fragrance of Gan Eden. Mitzvot have a fragrance of Gan Eden. And when you learn Torah, it smells good. And it looks good. There's a light around you. You're complete. Everything is on. All the lights are on. When a person is accepting upon himself to do the mitzvah, I'm accepting upon myself to do tshuva. Ribono Sholam, I cut my chayut from you. I realize I can't do it. Where Bnei Israel was standing under Har Sinai, and we said, Naaseh v'nishma. HaKadosh Baruch Hu crowned them with two crowns of glory. Naaseh v'nishma. Chazal tells us that at that moment, they reached the level of Adam HaRishon before the sin. When a person does tshuva, Ribono Shel Olam, how could I have done this? I am so sorry. How could I have done this? What I was thinking. At that moment, that instant of tshuva, at that moment, he has a crown of Naaseh v'nishma. He accepted upon himself Malchut Shamayim. He is mekabel upon himself to keep the mitzvot again, to keep the Torah again. After Adam Rishon ate from that apple, man, those apples. Yeah, one apple a day keeps the doctor away, but that one apple kept us from Gan Eden forever and ever. And there is a sword there, right? There's an angel with a sword, a revolving sword. You can't enter Gan Eden. You live your life with tshuva. You made tshuva. I can't believe I did it. Don't be obsessed with what you did. Learn from it. Learn. I made a mistake. This was wrong. Learn from your mistake. And says, I'm not doing this again. If you live with this tshuva, you're reaching yourself a level of Adam HaRishon before the sin. And guess what happened? Adam HaRishon went to Gan Eden. Again, you're not going to have Gan Eden in this world. However, the revolving sword and entering Gan Eden for you will stop working. You'll go like the Matrix between the blades, like this. That's what happens. And we don't do it because we don't think. Why? Why? Because everything is okay today. There's no remorse. There's no guilt. There's no shame. If I'm not ashamed of what I've done, if I'm not ashamed of what I have done, how could I ever admit that I did wrong? It's good. Today, out of the closet, in the closet, into the dry cleaning, into the dryer. You know, give me a break. A little shame. Dignity. We don't have dignity. It's okay to do whatever you want. You want to put two bare-bowling things in your head like this to look like, go ahead and do this, cut here, put. Makara, what happened here? Why, it's all okay. And it's not all okay. There are consequences. And the reason why we do it over and over and over and over and over and over, because we don't realize the impact that it has on us. You're right, one cigarette is not going to kill you. You smoke, one cigarette is not going to kill you. However, that nicotine that you took from your cigarette, just one cigarette in your life, will stay in your lungs forever. It's tar. It's oil. Your lungs are not going to spit it out. It stays there. You don't believe me? Ask doctor. Hey, Dr. Donnie, how do those lungs look for a smoker? So what a sight, huh? They should take and repave some of the roads here in Queens. You know, it's horrible. You know, so much time, it goes nowhere. Right now, you don't feel anything. I mean, I smoke one cigarette. I feel good. I feel cool. I feel like a man. Right? But it doesn't do anything to me. Smoke it, man. It's good. But all of a sudden, after a few years, I don't know, 30, 20 years of every morning, like this every morning, one day you get a call from the doctor. The doctor says, sir, we need to see you in the office. Can you come to the office? Yes, sure, doctor. What's the matter? We saw some spots on your lungs on the x-ray. It didn't come out clean. And then he's like, oh my goodness, Rabbi, what should Rabbi HaKadosh Baruch Hu is doing this for me? Well, he didn't put the cigarette in your mouth. You did it. That's exactly what happens. We don't think about, not even two steps, one step ahead. When you're about to do something, you should try to think what will happen 3-4 steps ahead, not one step ahead. Some people don't think at all. And how horrible that is. How many times you think you're going to live? You live once. You live once. You better do it right. Oh, I'll come again, reincarnation. Yeah, who told you that? Who told you that? You come once, better do it right. Is that a way to live your life? What are you putting your emphasis on? Did you determine in your mind what is right and what is wrong? What is right is what is going to be right today and tomorrow, and was right yesterday and 1,000 years ago. The only thing that would offer you that is Torah, Rabotai, and man. Is Torah. What is right today was wrong yesterday. What was wrong yesterday is terrific today. Who knows what's going to be tomorrow? And we don't think about it. And we don't think about the damage that we cause ourselves, nor the damage we cause to others. Because I don't care. I'm allowed to do what I want. And then I say, well, I'm sorry. Can you forgive me? Why do you ask somebody to forgive me? Why? So you can continue doing what you're doing? Or you really mean it? Are you going to change your ways? If you had done something wrong and you went to someone and says, excuse me, you know, I'm really sorry, please forgive me. You expect what? The person to say, of course I'll forgive you, not a problem. But what will happen if the person will tell you, you want me to forgive you? Fine. What are you going to do to change? How are you going to make sure you're not going to do this again? Because I'm going to tell you what. You do this again, I'm going to knock your teeth out. Or pop your kneecap. And you know, what are you going to do? Did you think about what you did? You know what you did to me? You know the words that you told me, the way you hurt me, they were like nails in the wood. You put 5-inch nails into my heart. It hurts me. So what are you going to say? Okay, I'll pull those nails out for you. Well, thank you very much. Well, what are you going to do about the holes that your nails left in my heart? How are you going to fix that? That you're never going to be able to fix. That you're never going to be able to fix. You hurt me to such a way, I'll be mochel you. I forgive you because you're dumb. But what are you going to do with my pain? What are we doing to Ribono Shel Olam? How could we do this? How in the world can we deliberately say, I care of them. How come Yom Kippur, Chatanu Lefanecha, goodbye and good luck and so on and so forth. It's shalom, it's okay. What do you think? What are you going to say? And we all, whether you believe, whether you're an atheist or shmateist or shmate, what are you going to say when you're going to meet Ribono Shel Olam in Shamayim? Can you explain what you just did before? You know, the 19, whatever it is, or I'm still 19, you know. 2014 at can you explain what you did? That's what you're going to say. You're not going to be able to say anything. What an embarrassment. You don't know what hell is. You want to know what hell is. You want to know what's punishment in Olam Haba. I'll tell you what punishment in Olam Haba. I'll tell you what punishment is. In Olam Haba, there's no punishment of like whipping you with fire and stuff like this. There's no such thing. There's no such thing. There's no body. What is there for me to whip? I'm going to tell you what the punishment in hell is. Embarrassment. Embarrassment. Now, there's going to be double embarrassment. Embarrassment for what you did. I mean, you knew that God sees you. Today, I mean, the police puts cameras in every intersection. You saw in Metropolitan and Lefferts, they put two cameras. Yeah, I need security. You know, invasion of privacy, but that's okay. I don't care. I'll do what I want. So the police can see you anywhere. You think God cannot see you anywhere? And you still did what you did. So that's going to be one embarrassment. Huh? As they say, they caught you with the pants down. Oh, skirt down. The second embarrassment, which is going to be greater, they're going to show you the consequences of what you had done and what you could have become and you didn't. And I'm going to tell you something. You know, you say it's like an arrow in my heart. Let me tell you, this is like a bulldozer into your heart. Why? Because you can't fix it. You could have been here and you end up there. And there's nothing you can do to fix it. And you know why? You had a choice. And you did it over and over and over and over again. You had all the time to watch your YouTube. You had the time to watch your this and to watch The Voice and America Has Talent or No Talent. America has lately very little talent, unfortunately. And you watch American Idol worshiping and you know, all the other thing, right? You watch all these things. For that you had time. But really, did you have time to do something? And to actually forget about doing something. Do you have a time to think about what you have done? Or how you wasted your day? Your day that is wasted has never, ever come back. The day that you wasted is never coming back. Ever. It's every moment a moment is a unique moment in history of the universe. That it's never gonna come back. Did you ever think about that great waste? I mean, you're becoming stingy on pennies. But on time, you're not. 1 minute, I need to say a bracha. Baruch atah Adonai melech haolam shehakol nehyah bidvaro.
Amen.
And that is the problem. That is the problem. We have emptiness, and we fill up with the wrong things. That wrong things does not give us nourishment. We don't supply enough spiritual food and nourishment to our neshama. We think we can fool HaKadosh Baruch Hu the way we fool everybody. Rabotai, we don't fool anyone. The only one we fool is ourselves. Fill your life, before you fill your life, with substance. Seal some of the gaps. Your beautiful vessel, your Chinese vase of a soul, a porcelain masterpiece, has holes in it, which all the fulfillment comes out of, all the nourishment comes out. Let's close those holes first. How are you going to close the holes? Very simple. You need to identify them first. How do you identify? You sit down and you actually look at the light. Measure your life according to the light. What light? The light of Torah. Don't measure your life according to what this agenda says, or this political party says, or what the Washington Compass says, or the New York Slimes, or the LSD, WLSD, or whatever says that. Look at the light of the Torah. Look at the truth. Be truthful. Look at the light of the Torah. See your holes. Close your holes. Fill it up with substance. Put some meaning in your life. Do you have a meaning in your life? Do you have a meaning in your life? Let me tell you, you don't have any meaning in your life. What's your meaning? What's your goal? To have money? Money is not a goal. Money is not an issue. Money is nothing. Money is something that I do transaction with. Money for itself has no value. No value to money. If the government wants, tomorrow your money is worth nothing. They devalue your money at $1 million. Then tomorrow it's worth $100,000. Or it's worth nothing. Look in the 30s. Money was worth nothing. The paper, the money was printed, was more expensive, was worth more than the money itself. There was no value to the money. Look in Germany what happened. It's not a goal. Ultimately, everybody wants to be happy. Want to have happiness. But what's happiness? To go to Disneyland? That's not happiness. Disney World, whatever Disney you go. That's not happiness. Happiness means meaning in your life. To have fulfillment and meaning. So you need to look very carefully at your actions. Close the gaps. Fill up with appropriate. And then you plant something beautiful inside. And then it grows. And then you have offsprings. And that's how you're going to get rid of your vicious cycle of doing another avera and another avera and another avera, to the point you're going to say, you know what, this is not for me. You're not going to do that? You're going to suffer a lot. And you know where you're going to suffer a lot? Here. You know why? Because this life has no meaning. And life without meaning is not worth living. You can take one little seed. You take one tomato seed and you plant it. You have a plant. A plant gives you tomatoes. Take a little care of it. I don't know. How many tomatoes? 20, 50 tomatoes. Every tomato has about 100 seeds. Guess what? You can go into business now from one seed, because now you have a lot of tomatoes. And you collect it, and so on and so forth. These are your mitzvot. The seed of your mitzvot, the seed of your life, needs a ground to plant it in. And it's a vessel that can hold the water, to hold the dirt, to bloom, to have children, to hand it over. You need to come to HaKadosh Baruch Hu Yom Kippur. You need to come to HaKadosh Baruch Hu Yom Kippur. You're coming to visit the king, or to show your face, or to talk to him face to face, like you always do, but this time he came for you. You don't come empty-handed. You go to somebody's house, you have to bring something. You don't come empty-handed. The king is coming to you. He came to you. You don't come empty-handed. What are you going to come up with? What do you have to offer? You want another year. What are you going to do to earn this other year? Your fate has already been determined in Rosh Hashanah. Yom Kippur is going to be sealed. What are you going to say for yourself? I mean, we do know you're going to do it over again. So why should we give you another year? Are you a good investment? Are you worthwhile? Because for that, the Gemara says, we'll take your years, we'll give it to somebody else who is worth it. Did you make your case? Are you going to make your case? Yom Kippur It's time for you to get closer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And you're only going to be able to make your case if you feel closeness to Him. If you feel removed, if you concentrate about the food, if you concentrate about your headache from your caffeine, it's going to be very hard for you to make the case. So start thinking today. It's a little late, but it's not too late. Start thinking today about how you're going to make the case. Nobody's perfect. That's good. Everybody makes mistakes. Everybody makes mistakes. But a mistake is not a mistake unless you learn from it. If you repeat it again, then it's a mistake. If you learn from it, it's a learning experience. You want to make yourself a good investment? Bring people to learn. Encourage people to learn. That encouragement of people to learn would, in a way, create the peer pressure for you to become better, because now you'll become a role model for others. People will look up to you, so you have to change your ways. So that's one way to afflict change in your life. Assume responsibility for others as well, not only for yourself. I don't think there's a better place to send people to help people to come to learn than here. So do that. Make yourself into a kli kodesh, not just a vase on a shelf or a jar in a cabinet. Make yourself into a holy vessel that will be worthwhile to be served the King with. Make yourself into a servant of Hashem. And that will be a good investment. It's not your school. It's not your bank. It's not your stocks. It's the Torah. And the Torah in you. You need to clean yourself as a vessel to hold the holy, pure Torah inside of you. You need to make your case. And I think we get somewhat of an idea today how to do so. So first of all, I wish everybody... not an easy fast, because there's no such thing as an easy fast. I don't like fasting. But I wish all to have a meaningful fast. You find meaning and substance in the spiritual of that day, standing in front of it. I wish you all a happy, healthy, and very meaningful year. The tefillah, your prayer should be mitkabel, accepted from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And everything that you wish good shall come true today. And all those chevre who need shidduch should get shidduch. And those who are dating, don't date for too long. You know, make your decision. And more than that, that we should all be partners in this great project that we call Yagdil Torah VeYadir. We shall all help other people come closer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, because our destiny mainly is dependent on Him. So have a wonderful year and Gmar Chatima Tova.